Hi, my name is Tori, and I am a doctor of physical therapy who specializes in pelvic dysfunction, which means I treat things that can go wrong around the pelvis. Today, I want to cover a requested topic, how to treat chronic or recurrent yeast infections. First of all, thank you so, so much for requesting. It seriously means the world to me, and I'm so honored to be doing request topics, so thank you. Secondly, know that medical treatment of yeast infections is outside of my scope of practice, as I cannot prescribe medication. But I can share how I would treat recurrent yeast infections based off of what I've seen work for women in the clinic and what I've learned from my research. Because this video is concerning recurrent yeast infections, as in four or more infections per year, I want to dive straight into the less obvious potential causes and potential treatments of recurrent infections, as it has been my experience that women who do have these recurrent infections tend to already be aware of things like antibiotics and spermicide potentially causing infections, and also tend to have already implemented the more common or popular, for lack of a better word, lifestyle changes that can be helpful, like replacing synthetic underwear with cotton underwear and avoiding tight-fitting clothing and eliminating douching and scented feminine products and things like this. I will outline the more common causes of yeast infections, the lifestyle changes, and why those lifestyle changes could be helpful in the description below, just in case any of that information is helpful to you. So then, in this video, we will begin by talking more about yeast and the vaginal environment in general. Then I will propose what I think are the two most important questions when it comes to navigating recurrent yeast infections. And I'll end by taking you down some potential treatment pathways. Timestamps and links to all of the studies that I mention will be in the description below. And last bug I want to put in your ear before we begin. If you are working through what you think are recurrent yeast infections, but you don't have that telltale white clumpy discharge or that white film in and around your vagina, I highly suggest that you rule out lichen sclerosis. Lichen sclerosis is an inflammatory skin condition that can affect the genital skin, and it can manifest in extreme vaginal itchiness and burning, which can be misdiagnosed, especially if you're diagnosing yourself as a yeast infection. If this sounds like it could be you, follow up with a gynecologist, get the affected tissue tested, and rule out lichen sclerosis. All right then, let's begin by talking more about yeast and vaginas. First of all, recall that your vaginal environment, much like your gut, is full of microorganisms that play different roles in keeping you healthy. This collection of vaginal microorganisms is often referred to as the vaginal flora or the vaginal microbiota. Secondly, recall that yeast is a fungus, not a bacteria, which is why antifungals, not antibiotics, are used to treat yeast infections. More specifically, yeast infections are caused by different species of candida, a species of yeast that is found not only in humans, but also in lots of animals and can exist in our vaginal flora without causing us any harm. To quote this 2016 review article, species from genus Candida have a wide distribution in nature and can be found in humans, domestic and wild animals, as well as in diverse environments, including hospitals. These yeasts belong to the normal flora of humans and can colonize the mucosal surfaces of the genital, urinary, respiratory, and gastrointestinal tracts, as well as oral cavity, nails, scalp, and skin. However, Candida species can be commensal organisms, meaning they benefit from living in us, but they do not help or harm us, or transform a symptomless colonization into an infection. Thus, these species are characterized as opportunistic and can change from harmless to pathogenic or hurtful upon variation of the host conditions, aka upon variation of what's going on inside of us, the human host. So most women, if not all women, will carry some form of candida in their vaginal flora, but they will have no yeast infection. For example, this 2004 study looked at the vaginal flora of 1,248 women women who had no symptoms of a yeast infection at baseline, 4 months, 8 months, and 12 months time. As it turns out, 70% of those women were colonized by vaginal yeast at one or more of those visits. So it stands to reason then that there must be some balance of candida and vaginal defense mechanisms that allows candida to live in the vaginal environment and remain commensal in nature. In other words, there must be some defense mechanisms in place that allow candida to live in the vagina without causing harm to the human host in the form of a yeast infection. It is the other microorganisms living in the vaginal flora that defend against a yeast infection or candida overpopulation. Calling back to that 2016 review, it is specifically a type of bacteria called lactobacilli that are the primary defense against candida overpopulation. Lactobacilli help to keep candida under control by competing with candida cells for adhesion sites, such as epithelial or skin receptors, to which lactobacillus has higher affinity. This just means the lactobacilli are more likely to adhere or stick to the vaginal skin than candida. Lactobacilli secrete biosurfactants that physically decrease candida binding, and most lactobacillus strains release hydrogen peroxide and fatty acids that inhibit candida overgrowth. So lactobacilli are pretty awesome bacteria that live naturally in our vagina and help fight against candida overpopulation and keep an overall healthy, balanced vaginal environment. So then, when it comes to managing recurrent yeast infections, one of the most important questions in my mind is, what is changing in the vaginal environment and allowing candida to overpopulate or cause an infection? Another super important piece of the puzzle to consider is that there are different types of species of candida that can live in the vagina, which means there are different types of species of candida that can cause yeast infections. Regardless, the most common species identified in women with yeast infections is called Candida albicans. Candida albicans is so common that within the scientific literature there is the acronym NCAC, non-Candida albicans candida, that is used to describe other species of candida. The reason that this is worth bringing up is because Candida albicans responds really well to a certain type of antifungal medication, to azoles. Monistat is a super common over-the-counter treatment for yeast infections, and it is an azole. Diflucan is a super common antifungal prescription, and it is an azole. And these medications are great if the type of candida causing your yeast infections is Candida albicans. But if you are suffering from recurrent infections, I propose, as does this 2005 study investigating non-Candida albicans, candida, and recurrent yeast infections, that the yeast causing your infections is likely not Candida albicans, which is why the common antifungal treatments aren't working. With this information in mind, I now propose what I would consider to be the two most important questions when it comes to trying to navigate recurrent yeast infections. Question number one, what is changing in my vaginal environment that is allowing candida to overpopulate and cause recurrent infections? Two, what species of candida is causing my infections? So often you go to the doctor and are given some sort of antifungal treatment based solely off of your subjective, based solely off of what it is that you say to the doctor. There's no vaginal swab. Why not get a vaginal swab and find out exactly what strain of yeast is causing your infection so that you can move forward with a better informed treatment plan? If it is Candida albicans causing your yeast infections over and over and over again, well then we need to refocus to that very first question. What is changing in your vaginal environment that's allowing Candida albicans to overpopulate over and over again? If it isn't Candida albicans causing your yeast infections, then you probably need a different kind of treatment, something other than an azole. All right, now let's go down a few different treatment pathways together. Let's say it isn't isn't Candida albicans that is causing your recurrent yeast infections, and that's why you're getting recurrent infections, because you're trying to treat them with an azole. A treatment option that I've seen work wonders in clinic is a combination of boric acid vaginal suppositories and vaginally inserted probiotics that contain lactobacilli. As this 2011 study demonstrates, non-Candida albicans Candida does respond to boric acid. It acts as an effective antifungal where azoles do not. And as we've discussed, lactobacilli are amazing natural defense mechanisms against Candida overpopulation. So why not give the vaginal environment a boost of lactobacilli during treatment? In the clinic, I usually see these boric acid suppositories inserted once a day for 7 to 14 days, then 2 times a week for about a month or so, paired with a probiotic inserted vaginally 2 to 3 times a week or so while taking the boric acid. The strains of lactobacilli that I understand to be very important when it comes to vaginal health are lactobacilli, rhamnosus, and reuteri. These are the 2 strains of lactobacilli that you may want to look for in a vaginal probiotic. With all of that being said, please, please, please speak with your physician before you start this type of protocol. Make sure that it is a safe treatment for you and that the yeast infection that you are treating is caused by a non-Candida albicans Candida. The other treatment pathway to consider: you've tried boric acid and the vaginal probiotics and you're not getting results. You're still getting recurrent infections. Then we have to fall back to that first question. Something must be going on in the vaginal environment that is promoting the overgrowth of this yeast. One potential cause to consider that I think goes under the radar a lot is hormones. I want to read you another quote from that 2016 review article that speaks to increased yeast infections during pregnancy and the relationship between yeast infections and hormones. The high incidence of yeast infections in pregnancy has been attributed to the increase of sex hormone secretion in pregnancy. In fact, during pregnancy, yeast infection prevalence is higher in the last trimester when levels of hormones are more elevated, even though symptomatic recurrences are more common throughout pregnancy. Furthermore, in non-pregnant women, the infection is more incident during the luteal phase of the menstrual cycle, which is the phase with the highest hormone secretion. Despite being accepted that yeast infections have a hormonal dependency, the mechanisms by which progesterone and estrogens act in the disease are not fully understood. So there is clearly a relationship between hormone levels and yeast infections. Hormones can change the vaginal environment somehow, we just aren't entirely sure what it is that they do. First question to consider: are you taking birth control pills? Are you taking oral contraceptives? Studies dating back to 1995 support that birth control pills, oral contraceptives, can contribute to recurrent yeast infections. Second question: do you have an IUD? As it turns out, yeast can adhere to medical devices like IUDs and create something called a biofilm, which is essentially a very structured community of yeast that is very strongly attached to the surface of, in this case, an IUD. This phenomenon has been studied, and if you do have a biofilm on your IUD and that is the cause of your recurrent yeast infections, you do need to get the IUD removed. Third question: you aren't taking birth control pills, you do not have an IUD. Have you been tracking your symptoms? If not, track your symptoms and track your menstrual cycle. As that 2016 review article pointed out, the luteal phase of your cycle, which happens after ovulation, involves a big change in hormone levels. Are your symptoms happening in tandem with the luteal phase of your menstrual cycle? If this is the case and the boric acid probiotic vaginal reset isn't working for you, you can still manage your symptoms via your diet. As we've discussed, yeast is a type of fungus, which means it's alive. It needs certain nutrients to survive. Since Candida are a type of commensal organism, which means we don't need them in the vaginal flora so long as they're not overpopulating and causing an infection, they aren't hurting us, but they also aren't helping helping us. If you want to effectively starve out candida, you can with a sugar-free, grain-free, dairy-free diet, otherwise known as the candida protocol. If you know your symptoms are cyclical and they are happening during that luteal phase of your menstrual cycle, then you can pair the candida diet with your luteal phase in order to create a really inhospitable environment in the vagina for candida. In other words, there would be about 10 to 14 days a month where you'd follow the candida protocol in order to make sure that it's really, really hard for candida to grow inside of your vagina. Let's say the cause behind your recurrent infections isn't hormonal at all, and you've tried everything else that I've outlined in this video. The last idea that I can offer is using the candida protocol for at least 3 months, paired with taking a probiotic that has those strains of lactobacilli in it that I mentioned earlier. If it were me, I would try this for at least 12 weeks, because why not, with the intention being twofold: to not only starve out the candida if I can, but also create the optimal vaginal environment for the best candida defense. All right, thank you all so much for watching and also for requesting. Please, if you found this video helpful, don't forget to like it and share it, and please feel free to comment anything in the comment section below. I do try really hard to read and respond to all of my comments. Finally, please subscribe to my channel for more content, not only about pelvic things, but also about life things. Check me out on Instagram. I fully intend to give my Instagram more love. I promise I'm working on it. And thank you so much again for watching. I hope that you have a wonderful rest of your day, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.